check with the day, my people. You know what it is, the Don Tony Teflon, Lord Evans, and we're back at you with another one. And this is the Making of a Murderer Epic Review Q&A. First Q&A we're going to do right here. So we took questions from the first review, and we're going to have Laura and myself, if I can. Not, I really can't because I don't know too much about ourselves. But Laura, answer all these questions. So Laura, you're looking very beautiful today. How are you?
Thank you. Good. How are you?
I am very well, very well. And thank you again for everyone that is joining us and watching us and doing this case. And I love this show, not the fact that the things that have the show, and I love the attention that it's got. And I love everyone who has come by to my channel and watched this show from Laura's channel. Anyone who's come from my channel to Laura's channel, thank you. Please subscribe to her channel and mine. So without further ado, I will go to the first questions for you, Laura. And it is, what the hell is going on when Sergeant Andrew Corbin called in to read the license plate for Halbach's RAV4? Did I read that right? Yes, I think so.
Oof. Okay, there's a lot of different stuff going on. And I say that because there's nothing definitive. There's a lot of probabilities and a lot of educated guesses. What I mean by educated guesses is, at first you watch the episode, you think, okay, there's a million different reasons he could have done that. But what we learned long after is that there was a piece of paper in there, like police form, I don't know what you call it, but it said that Teresa Halbach was reported missing on November 3rd, that she wasn't even missing, she was kidnapped on November 3rd, and in evidence was the car on November 3rd. Okay, how is that possible? Well, the only logical explanation is they found the car, she wasn't in it, they found her stuff, and he saw the car, wherever it may be, and called in the plates. Lo and behold, calls in the plates, and ding, 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 that's the phone call you hear because everything is recorded on dispatch. So, I mean, that's really the only logical, educational understanding of why he called in the plates, because it was sitting in front of him. How it was sitting in front of him, how it ended up on the list, it's all debatable. Nobody really knows for sure.
I hear you. And I can't see it being any other way. They, in order for you to call this point, you have to look at it. There's no reason for you not to be looking at this unless you, this is just jump. This has popped into your head, so let me just call this random plate out of nowhere. No, it doesn't happen like that. People.
Now, the theory is, I've heard this from a lot of different people. The theory is that, hey, they gave him the plate number, so he called it in. Not happening. Because as a person that comes from family members that are cops, ex-husband's family that are cops, there is absolutely no way that a cop is going to call in a license plate to dispatch from a mom or dad or brother or whoever, giving them the license plate. They don't then call it a dispatch and say, whose car is this? That's just not the way police work. They could have taken it and then they would have said, hey, dispatch, here's that license plate number of the girl that's missing. That they would do. Not ask them, hey, whose plate is this? Let me run this. It just doesn't work like that.
Exactly.
So, that's, I mean, my theory, and I've said it before, is my theory is they either found the car at the bottom of the river and pulled it up because it did look kind of iffy. How they would have dried it, I don't know. I haven't gotten that far yet. But they found it on the side of the road. She wasn't in it. There was some blood in the car. Her, you know, belongings were in it. So they figured she was kidnapped because all her belongings were in it and she wasn't there, but her car was. To me, that's a logical explanation of the car and why he would have called in the plates, why he didn't know whose plates it was, and why her belongings were still there and she wasn't.
And then you'd have to explain how that car got from wherever it was to the Avery property.
Well, that's a whole nother realm, but how it got to the Avery property is because somebody put it there. And it was talk about some girl, Tammy. Some girl, Tammy, supposedly told Steven that the cops put the car there. Whether it's true or not, nobody knows. But there's a lot of aerial views that show the car was under a tarp, or they say it was under a tarp. And because it was under a tarp, nobody could see it. But if you watch the footage from the aerial, when they supposedly went up there, the only aerial footage there is, it's very weird because they're focused on this tarp. So my theory is, okay, it stands out to me. They were looking to see either where they were going to place the car or letting other people know, like other police know exactly where it was underneath the tarp. You don't know if it was under the tarp or it came there the night before, but too much surrounded on the 4th for them to all of a sudden find it on the 5th. I mean, it was just too weird.
I hate. So we shall go to the next question. And next question is, what went on with the jury deliberations? Was there a recording artist on the jury?
A recording, like a singer recording artist?
Yes.
Not that I know of. Was there?
I don't know. This is the question I was asked. Is there some recording artist?
I don't think so.
On the jury?
Not that I know of.
No.
I mean, they had a seedy jury. The jury was, oh, maybe because they're talking about Brad. Brad Dassey, because he sings or he tries to sing. Yeah. He tries to do some rap.
Oh, and he was on the jury?
No. He's Brandon's half brother.
Oh.
But someone asked you that? I don't know. I never heard that before.
Yeah, someone did.
Did they follow it up with anything of why?
No, that's what they said. Something about let me see. I will try to research that question. I'll get to the next question with you while I'm doing the next question with you. I'll see if I can research that a little bit myself. So the next question is there any innocent explanation or any type of way that the hole could have gotten in Avery's blood in that vial?
Again, debatable subject. I have people sending me information about the vial and blood and the EDTA stuff that I wouldn't even think of going there because I could sound like a mumbling fool trying to explain it. Mm-hmm. If you look at the top of a stopper or a top of that kind of vial, there is no way that you would see that kind of hole. I mean, that's a given, no matter what they say. You wouldn't have that type of hole in it. So to me, it's granted obvious that something was stuck in there. I had very numerous conversations with a lab tech who told me that he tried duplicating with a 6-gauge, an 8-gauge, a 12-gauge, an 18-gauge, and a 24-gauge needle and could not replicate that hole at all. So that was kind of interesting, though, that no matter what she tried, she couldn't get that exact same hole. So she doesn't know where it came from. On the flip side of that, if you put a hole in blood, it's going to get out on the top, and it never did. So it was just kind of weird. To say definitively where the blood came from, I don't know. I have a theory the vial is not even applicable. But, I mean, you never know. That's something that we're going to have to wait for Zelna to find out because none of us are really too sure. Or none of us can even be too sure.
Oh, I see. All right, so I have found some type of thing that online on Google real quick about that recording artist, supposedly recording artist. I guess the man's name was Richard Mahler.
He wasn't a recorder.
I get that. They're saying that he had some a local band. I guess that's what they must mean, something with him in it. He must have been in a local band, but he must have been listed on the documentary as an international recording artist. But he is just a person that was in a local band. And was he related to someone else on the jury or something like that? And that's how we got two other people on the jury, something like that. That's what it seems to say. But that's a name that pops up, that this guy was on the jury. He was on the documentary. He was listed as an international recording artist, but he's just a person who has a local band.
That's the first I've ever heard of that. Yeah, I think he's in like a local cover band.
Yeah. So.
Far cry from an international one.
Yeah.
But I guess. He is whoever asked you that kind of got jury confused, because he was one of the people that voted for Avery being innocent.
Okay.
And the problem is, again, can never be confirmed, just speculation, but the speculation came from his daughter. It was all sorts of speculation that the cops caused a car accident for his daughter, and that's why he had to leave, you know, a couple of days before jury. He will tell you that he had to leave because, he'll tell you that it was that the daughter said the cop showed up, and there's no way that the daughter would have known. There's no way the cops would have known because nobody called the cops. So how did the cops know there was a car accident? So that speculation was going around. Judge Willis, who seems to be much more, much better than the other judge, than Fox, he claims in sworn testimony that he allowed the jury to leave because he was worried about his wife was divorcing him, or somebody was in the hospital. It was two completely different stories. So whoever's telling the truth, I don't know. Did Richard want his 15 minutes of fame? I don't know. You know, and made up this car story because the judge says totally different story.
It seems like he wanted his 15 minutes of fame. If you ask me, that's what it seems like he was going for there.
What?
It seems like he did looking for some quick fame, this cat. Especially, it's what it seems like to me.
I agree with the international recording eyes now. I think he's on like a local cover band.
Yeah, I think probably documentary people probably went to him and said, "What do you do for a living?" He probably said, I'm an international recording artist. And they're like, "Oh, really?" And he put it in there. And then they had to check up, and people probably said, "Wait a second, who is this?"
Exactly.
on the jury. Do we got here's a seal or is it somebody like that or one of these guys on the jury? And it turned out to be this dude.
Yeah, he was a juror that was dismissed. And like I said, it's all a matter of who you believe. You know, normally I would say I totally in favor for the judge because, I mean, why would a judge lie under testimony? But then you can look at this whole case and say, well, gee, I wonder. So that's why it's, you know, I don't want to say who's lying and who's not. So I'll leave it at that. But two different stories.
Right.
But I can't say definitively he wasn't the one that got other people to turn. That was a totally different juror. That was a juror that replaced him, is the one that got everyone to turn, because he was the son of, I'm sorry, he was the father of a Manitowoc County policeman. That's who got everyone to turn.
Nice. So the next question we have here is, now, is it common that the defendant cannot be allowed to use present other people for the case, other murderers, someone else to do this murder? Is that common cause, or is it usually allowed for you to be able to present someone else as the murderer in the case?
It is 100% common. It's called a Denny motion in Wisconsin. I honestly don't know if New York has one. I'm sure they do, and here's why. If you're on trial for murder, or I'm sorry, I'll reverse this. If you're on a jury, and let's say you did 10 juries in a row, 10 murder cases in a row. In retrospect, the only thing that a prosecutor has to prove is, I said that reversed. The only thing that a defense attorney needs to prove is reasonable doubt. He needs to prove that there is reasonable doubt to believe that somebody else did this. The prosecution is supposed to be able to prove beyond a reasonable doubt, unequivocally, no questions asked, that you did this. In our court of law, there's a reason why you can't just say, well, Tony did it. I'm going to kill my ex. Well, Tony did it. Okay, was Tony at the scene? Yeah, Tony was at my house that day. You know, and then he left all crazy. Okay, Tony, who were you with? I was by myself. Like, okay, so I left our house. What's the big deal? Every single murder case would do that. That's why you can't. So it's not that they weren't able to present. You have to meet a certain criteria. You have to meet three criteria in order for you to present somebody else. motive. I don't want to give all three, but it's motive and two other things. That as long as you can prove it, that, you know, there was a reason. Like people say Kratz did it. Well, what was his motive? Okay, let's say money. Did he meet the criteria? Was he in the area? Was he, you know, like things like that.
Opportunity.
Like, yeah. You can meet those three things and it makes sense, then yes, you can present somebody else. But you can't just only go out there for logical reasons and say, hey, Tony did it. I know Tony did it. Nobody would ever go to jail.
Yeah, it can't turn into a Scooby-Doo murder mystery case.
Exactly. And that's all the Getty Motion does. It does not stop. There was some other videos going around where people were saying, you know, it stopped them from being able to, you know, post evidence or, you know, present evidence. It had nothing to do with evidence. The only thing that they had to show was they had to meet these three things in order to present somebody else. And there was nobody else that could meet all three. That's what, you know, definitively. That's why they didn't.
I hear you. Right. So next question, it is, why was Halbach's pelvic bone discovered in the quarry? why was it discovered in the quarry? That's a third, discovered in three spots, right? Bones?
Yes, that is correct. That question I can answer with the question. It's only if you believe that they were Teresa Halbach's bones, period. The more I said this weeks ago, and I told everybody, you know, you heard it here first. The more that comes out, the more it is proven it is not Teresa's bones. The latest beliefs from all the evidence that's coming out, even more evidence that's coming out, is the fact that Teresa and Carmen were related through the mother, like I said weeks ago, but were related through the mother. And that's all we know so far. But a lot of people believe that Teresa was given a proper burial, and that she is dead, but she was given a proper burial and her family just went along with it because they believe Stephen killed her. Mm. Which is something I said a long time ago, but now it's starting to come out like, okay, this, you know, this block fits into this square and this circle fits into this square. Okay, we're no longer trying to take a triangle and shove it into a circle because it kind of makes sense. Now it's just all fitting in together.
Yeah, I hear you. And people, common sense, right? I said, we got to use it.
That's what we got to use here, right?
To get this situation going. So if it's not her bones, I guess we shall soon find out. But that's most likely the reason why. So next one question is, why was Kayla's false statement admitted to being false in court allowed to be used in the prosecution's closing statement in the Brandon Dassey case?
Because the prosecution felt like they could do whatever the fuck they wanted, however they wanted, whenever they wanted. That was the problem. And that's what they did, and that's what they continued to do. And there's nothing that the defense could have done because the judge allowed it. That's why. And Fox is corrupt. Fox is Dassey's judge. Is as corrupt as probably the best of them. And I'm totally convinced of that.
Unbelievable. You know, and just the fact that they got away with it, you know what I mean? And it just, the judges sat there to let them do it. This just shows you that they were out to get this dude.
I got an email from somebody who lives there who, you know, was transplanted there from Florida, blah, blah, blah. She told me that, and it could be checked out by public records, but I never got the address from her and I haven't really had time to double check. But she said that a lot of her friends live in Fox's neighborhood. I guess he's in like some kind of, you know, gated community. Like, his house is the only house that has not gone down in value. The only one. Everybody else's house has gone down in value but his. Now, who does your assessments? The county.
Mm-hmm. It all goes back to money. It all comes back to money in the end, folks. Everything revolves around money. Follow the money. That's how you follow everything. All right, we have another one right here. It's from, I think, Rebecca selected. She says, hey, Laura, just wondering about this letter stating that the body had been burnt somewhere else. with all the snooping and watching around and watching videos, I don't hear anyone saying anything about that.
We've done a lot of work on that, but again, it's bone stuff and none of us are archaeologists to know what burnt bones in, you know, a smelter looks like compared to burnt bones, you know, in an open fire. Until Clash of Clans Final Regiment, I know he became a fan of yours. He actually owns like a lot of land and he did a huge bonfire, videos out. We did two parts. I guess animals or whatever ate some carcass. I forgot what animal it was, but he had the whole bones, the vertebrae, everything, put it together, showed it. Burned it the first time in, I don't know, 2 hours, 3 hours, nothing really happened. Second time, he burnt them with accelerants. There's pictures like 15 feet high that have burned for hours upon hours upon hours, like 7 hours. He couldn't even go there and he couldn't touch anything for like 24 hours. He pulled apart the bones. They were perfectly fine. They were a little black, but they were perfectly fine. So not saying that those bones weren't burned, but they were absolutely not burned in a bonfire or an open pit, because like in the beginning, everyone was saying that there's no way that, you know, flames could get that hot. There, it's 100% correct. There's no way those flames would have got that hot. Because, I mean, when you see the fires that Johnny did, there's no way.
And I'll definitely put the link to that, those videos in the description. Absolutely. So you can take out those videos. And listen, people, there is no way you burn bones in a fire, bonfire, and they turn to that. Anyone just to think it is crazy. It's just,
and
it's
the smell, impossible. The smell of a body and hair and everything, nobody's going to smell that for miles. I mean, you're in New York. You remember 9/11. Stunk for months, months.
There's no doubt. Granted,
it's a lot more people, but I mean, burn your hair and it stinks. You know, let alone an entire body in an open pit. I'm sure Mom and Dad Avery would have seen it.
Exactly. And so we try to keep this, because the last one was like 60 minutes. We're trying to keep this one down. This is going to be our last question we take. It's probably the most important one. So Ed could have the best answer. Who killed Teresa Halbach?
That's a hell of a question. No idea. I could also play devil's advocate and say if she's even dead. Who knows? I can tell you that Manitowoc had a few, I think there were two other missing girls in the area at the time. So, I mean, it's anyone's game. I don't know who killed him, who killed her. Not my job to decide who killed her. I can tell you who didn't kill her. I don't think that Kratz killed her. I don't think the police killed her. I do not think Brendan or Steven killed her. I'm debating on a few others, but in my heart of hearts, it wasn't the police, it wasn't Kratz. As much as I would love to say Kratz is their murderer, he's not.
No.
And I don't believe it was Ryan. Absolutely don't think it was Ryan. And that's really about it.
It's hard. Listen, in all honesty, people, you know, this is real life. So this is not like it's a book or anything like, so for me, this is say, I think this person did it. It affects, not that anyone's watching this, but it can affect somebody's life. And I ain't trying to affect people's lives like that. Now I have my suspicions about certain people that I think should answer a couple of more questions like that. That one guy who was dating the kid's mother. What's his name?
That's Pat Tadish.
Yeah.
I actually received a letter from Barbara Sunday that asked me to stop blaming her husband because I'll give it to you, but that stop blaming her husband because she's been married to him for like 9 years and he's not a murderer. I said, where did that come from? And I said, you know what? I would love to get Scott on a show. Let's clear the air. I'm not the only one that thinks he's guilty. Let's clear the air. Never heard.
I'm not saying he is, he's not. I'm just saying that if anyone should answer some more questions, I think it would be him. That would be the guy I would like to ask a couple of questions myself.
A lot of them. Dan O'Donnell, I want to get on a show. He won't listen. Maybe you can get him on, Tony. I'm trying to get Dan O'Donnell. Handle is Dan O'D Radio at Dan O'D Radio.
All right.
I want to get to head with him. I think you can mediate. He won't answer me.
All right. We'll see if we can work that. I will see if I can work that out, no doubt. And see, you know, Teflon Don, I get things on. I'm known for getting people together on a round table, so this is something I could probably pull off. And if I do pull it off, we'll definitely have that going on. So, like, once again, we will be doing the part two, follow up to the part one after this video, and we will finish off the Making of a Murder series and talk about the things we didn't talk about. And then we will do another follow up Q&A for that after. So let's say thank you, Laura, for joining me as usual. Oh, go on.
I want to interrupt you for a second. You said something before that I think needs to be addressed.
Go right ahead.
I'm doing my own video on it later, but tell your viewers too. Whether you believe Steven and Brendan are innocent or guilty is not the issue here. The entire issue is the setup and the corruption. I couldn't think of the word. The corruption in police departments, in state level, in government level. That's the issue here. So even if, you know, you think, oh, you know, they're just scum, they're this, they're that, it can happen to you. It can happen to me. Anybody can be a product of a corrupt court. I know I was, you know, and that's for me, that's what I'm fighting for. I cannot say definitively that they are guilty. I can't say definitively that they're innocent. I don't know. I can pretty much say that they're innocent, but I can't say it definitively. I can say definitively that there is serious corruption in this town. And don't think it can't happen to you. And that's what I'm fighting for.
No doubt. No doubt. And that's what it's all about, people. And just remember, these are people's lives. You know, there is a girl who's missing, presumably murdered or dead. Family suffered through this, you know. And it's imagine if it was your sister or someone in your family or something like that, you know, and you heard and the police came to you and told you, this is the guy who did it. This is the guy, you know. You just want some closure, you know. Even in the back of your head, if something's telling you, hey, something's off here, still, you just want that closure, you know. And situations like that could be happening with that family and everything else. So just, you know, before you say anything to people like, you know, oh, this motherfucker did it, this motherfucker, don't do it. It's not your job. Don't do it like that. Just, you know. It's like I said, ask some people, may have to ask a couple more questions and just, you know, keep an open mind and use your common sense. It's not hard to tap on this one. Really
right. Don't forget, makingamurderle.com. Check out my videos and that's it.
All right. So you go, is that also, you can find Laura's Twitter, her Twitter. You have a Twitter.
Oh my God.
All right. You have all those. Give all your links.
Twisted X Cons is my Twitter and I've been hitting Judge Janine and Ken Kratz, although it's not real Ken Kratz, but I've been hitting Judge Janine over and over and over on this conference that they're doing, which is pathetic in itself. You know Judge Janine, right? You know the whole story, right?
No, I don't.
Your viewers, all right, I'll make it real quick. Your viewers may not even know. Ken Kratz and Judge Janine, who is like Nancy Grace, she's out of New York. She was one of New York's best DAs for years and years and years. And she went to Fox, and now she's like, you know, Nancy Grace.
Josephine Parado or something like that. She's another last name, right?
And her and Kratz are doing a conference together to talk about this case, which there's no logic in that. Because what I don't understand is, who the fuck cares what we think? It doesn't matter what we think. You know, like, so big deal. People think he's guilty or innocent. What does that have to do with the price of beans in China? Whether we believe it or not, he's not getting out because we believe it or we don't believe it. So who are you pitching this to? And, you know, so a lot of us have been hitting Judge Neen, like, your reputation is done. Nobody likes you anymore. You know, you're crap. So
I didn't know people liked her from the beginning. I always hated that chick because she's just so... It's everything that comes out of her mouth. Well, she's first. Listen, she works for Fox. You don't have to say anything else. he works for Fox, a company that hired Mark Furman to be their analyst, racist ass Mark Furman. We're gonna make you our special investigator because you're perfect for Fox. We love racist people.
Exactly. The only New Yorkers know that. But I have to give a shout out. My girlfriend Patty works for Fox, so we can't be too mean to Fox.
Fox pays Patty's bill, so peace to Patty.
But yeah, so it's like this big conference. It's so ridiculous. And, you know, I was making a video about that late tonight. Like, who cares what we think of this? Like, why he even says, like, never before seen evidence. Why does it matter? We are nobodies. You know, like, who cares what we're way past, you know, like public opinion, you know, like whether let's say every single person. Okay, Kratz, you're correct. You're right. He must be so guilty. What's the point? You know, like, that's not, I guess Zellner's going to quit now. I mean, it's so stupid.
He should just, if he was smart, he'd keep his mouth shut, don't do nothing, and just go away. And anything you do, this Zellner's going to get your ass, big man. She's going to get your ass. And you got a big ass to get. And I tell you, he's going to take a bite of it. Just go away. Don't say nothing. That's the smartest thing. Well, come on, you're a prosecutor. You know people convict themselves. Don't say nothing.
Exactly right.
And don't think this Perot is your friend. She's trying. She's going for ratings. So if she can get you to say something thinking that you're a friend, you might get got, homie. Just keep your mouth shut.
I don't underestimate Brendan's attorneys either, though. They just did a conference yesterday for Northwest University. I think they're young, but they just did it for Northwest University. Not focused on Brendan, but focused on corruption and false confessions. That's how this needs to be done, you know, because that's making awareness of everybody. And I'm saying to myself, gee, that was my idea. But, you know, that's the awareness that needs to be made, not, you know, well, I have never before seen evidence that I'm going to show at this conference for $150 a ticket. Get the fuck out of here. It's no different than the other two cops, Weingart and whoever, that were doing a conference that thank God got canceled. Obviously, nobody wanted to hear it. But yeah, they're just, you know, oh, can't forget. There's articles that came out recently. Weingart put out an article that, you know, here's all the emails from people that show or at NBC or one of them put out a bunch of articles like, hey, you know, there's no way that they could have done this. That, you know, all these people were writing in saying, we back you, we support you. There were other cops. Of course you're going to get that kind of response from other cops in Wisconsin. Like, it was so stupid. And I really believe that even though they were under an order to produce all the emails, I don't believe that, you know, every single person's, you know, rah-rah cop. Give me a break. And I am all for cops. But no, that's ridiculous.
I am all for it. I can't say I'm all for cops. I'm just all for, you know, people. And cops are people. I'm all for good people. If those cops happen to be good people, then I'm all for them. If people are bad people, I ain't for them. No matter if you're a cop or whatever, I just like people, good people.
That's exactly right. I think it was like 98% of cops are good cops. Then you have the 2%. You know, 2% is the same amount that are in prison. There's 2.2 million prisoners, 20,000 of them are innocent. Okay, there's, I think, 800,000 cops, bad at math, I'm going to give a rough estimate, but, you know, 800,000 cops, so you have, you know, what, 10, you know, I'm rounding up, but 10,000 cops that are bad. Okay. You know what I mean? Like, it may seem like there's a lot of bad cops, but there's not. You look at all the cops out there, you know, for 2.2 million, there's 20,000.
That's what happens. I'll tell you, it's what cops are people, man. It's like you and me, like everybody else. And when you have a fucked up day, right? And you leave your house, your wife's fucking with you, your kid's fucking with you, the rent's due, whatever, your pipe's broken. Thing that happens with you and me when we go out to work, we just do our job, really, unless you're a big, big boss, maybe you could take it out on someone beneath you. they can take it out on anyone they feel like it, and some of them do. And some of them don't know how to take those problems at home and keep them home and not bring them to the workplace.
You're right. You're right. But let me interject something, though. And you're from New York. You can relate to this. I don't care if you're a criminal, if you are a cop, or you are a military. If you walk into my house for any reason and you have a gun that can kill me or my family, I'm going to say, what would you like me to do now, sir? Like, the mentality of, oh, he's a cop, I don't have to listen to them. It's a wrong mentality. Someone has a gun, listen. I don't care if it's, you know, if someone held a gun to your head and they're a robber, you know, and you're going to die, you're going to listen to what they tell you. Same thing with a cop. If someone has a gun, just listen. Just do what you're supposed to do and move on with your day. That's my feeling.
These cops, that's the whole thing. When they're having bad days for whatever reason, be disrespectful. If you talk back to them, they get so offended, and it just goes too far. It always goes too far. Like if they say, oh, turn off the radio. And yeah, I don't have to turn off the radio. Now, exactly. Most likely you don't have to. Most likely you don't have to, right? Most likely you are in the right. You're right. You don't have to. Now, if this guy's having a bad day, and this wife just fucked him. He's like, motherfucker, did I just ask you to turn the radio off? Now he's going through his head, but he has a gun. And he has your life in the balance. So just turn the fucking radio off.
Exactly.
And just get over it and get it over with. You know what I mean? That's what I say too. You know what I mean? But that's what I think situations that happen. These cops just need to be taught. Keep your goddamn personal life home. And a lot of these situations would not happen.
I agree. And also on the flip side, though, people need to listen. Like when we were growing up in New York, you could put a white cop in a bad, bad neighborhood, South Bronx. They weren't going to get killed. Why? Because they had respect for each other. That respect for each other went away somewhere. And the mayor of New York doesn't help at all. But it's, you know, the cops and criminals, for lack of a better way to say it, need to learn to respect each other again, and it wouldn't be all these deaths.
I remember back in the day, I used to drink the 40 ounces of Old Gold and St. Ives, and the cop would come by, and we'd have it out, and we'd see it, we'd take it, and we'd put it behind, we put it on the floor, put it behind our foot. They'd see us put it there, but they know that we were respecting them by, so we're not going to drink this in front of you, officer, we're putting it down. When you walk by, then we're going to pick it back up and drink it, and they knew that. And it was all good. You know what I mean? Because we weren't hurting nobody. They weren't hurting no one. And that's what it was. We weren't just like, we see a cop and we're like, oh, guzzle it down your face. No, I know you got a job to do. I'm not going to disrespect you. Do your job. I'm minding my business. I'm not hurting anybody. Have a nice day. You have a nice day. Let's keep it moving.
Exactly. And then they'd come back around and be like, what's up? And you're like, hiding it again.
Exactly.
So back around again.
Exactly. So you will hear more banter like this between me and Laura and something else that's not related to all this. That's, I will talk about that later. But we will bounce on this Q&A. You know where to find her. All her links and everything will be in the description box. So please do that. And all my stuff, you know where to find me, obviously on my channel and stuff like that. So if you like the way I do this, please thumbs up this. Please spread this across the realm. And please subscribe. And until next time, you know who it is. Peace.
That's me too. Peace.
And stay sexy.
That's it. Always.